What does a wild cast of characters, a world-famous dry lake bed, and two world-class roadsters have in common? Well, the answer to the mystery starts in this hideout behind the Hollywood Hills, where a crew of top builders pull double duty. And on this episode of Rides, we'll see their incredible projects, just as their company holds a celebration with a lot of guests, a lot of fun, and of course, a lot of amazing cars. They're the perfectly named shop known as Hollywood Hot Rods, right here on Rides. Still the early 60s here in certain areas of this retro-loving town known as Hollywood, California. Call it a time warp, call it a love of a simpler era, or just call it a lot of groovy folks hanging out and having fun.
Hi, I'm Davida, and I'd like to welcome you to Hollywood Hot Rods today. It's our one-year anniversary. And we've had a fabulous turnout. We're really excited to have you here.
Hollywood Hot Rods is a place where custom cars are both made and celebrated. And now that they've fired up over 52 weeks of turning out dream machines, it's time to cut loose. And that earlier mentioned time warp, well, we're about to pull one of our own, going back 3 months before the party. That's when a pair of new cars consisted of a few bare rails, two projects in search of some progress. And the man who was there in these early stages is a guy named Randy Ladd. Randy is a hot rod builder, and you'd hire him in your own shop, even if he wasn't your own brother. And this is the owner of the shop, Randy's brother, Troy. Troy combined his business degree with his love of cars, creating this place that builds hot rods in a very special way.
Basically, we're trying to build a traditional car with a traditional look.
But today, going after a traditional look doesn't always mean that you will build with traditional parts.
It's mostly just for styling, authenticity and styling. Drilled backing plates were fairly common on, 50s and 60s era styled cars. So that's what we're trying to build.
They're trying to build cars of yesterday that can run with the best of today's new cars. To do that, Troy needs team members like this masked man. His name is also Troy. Of course, the boss already has that label, so this guy has a carload of nicknames. Whatever he's called, he works on rides that span two different eras.
You know, they're supposed to look like they were built in the 50s or the 60s, but 90% of the parts on it are brand new.
Mostly brand new cars for clients who don't want to simply restore a classic. Clients like John Riddle, CEO of a clothing company and a certified car enthusiast.
I think I'm a late bloomer to the car deal. I'm the youngest son of two, and my older brothers have always had, the hot street cars, and we're always into the cars, and I didn't come to this until maybe five, six years ago. This didn't really have any interest in it. I was interested in Volkswagens, water-cooled Volkswagens, things like that, but never had the ability to do what I wanted to do.
What he wanted to do was have a hot rod, so he set Troy loose on the job. But no sooner was Troy ordering up parts when he got a call from John.
Once I was in the middle of that, he calls me up. He says, have you ordered that stuff yet? And I'm thinking, oh crap, he changed his mind. I'm like, no, I'm just about to. And he's like, double everything.
In other words, John now wanted two 32 Roadsters. So Hollywood Hot Rods did exactly what John requested. They doubled up on everything. Right now, the rear end of Roadster 2 is getting an adjustment. Randy is thinning out some of the leaf spring suspension because these two hot rods are going to be riding low.
That one. This one. We're going to find the, get the shocks, put the shocks in.
So while Randy and the mysterious man with many nicknames work on the suspension for Roadster 2, Troy is busy giving Roadster 1 a little Hollywood magic.
All in the name of looking good.
A facade now comes into play, making new disc brakes look like thinned aluminum drum brakes.
Kind of what hot rodding is about.
With this you get form and function.
If you were building a 1960s hot rod, you couldn't put disc brakes on a car of this era. But today, Troy can hide new performance inside a vintage look, truly combining those elements of classic form and contemporary function.
This is the drum itself. Again, it's not actually a drum. It's just a fake cover. And there it is.
Over on Roadster 2, the guys are getting ready to move to the front of the ride.
That's basically it for the rear. I think we're gonna go ahead and start assembling the front.
In the beginning, it was gonna be a quickie. I guess they always are. In the beginning, it was gonna be budget, quick, we'll just throw it together in bare metal, get it rolling for the summer, it'll cruise around in it. Well, one thing leads to another.
One thing leads to another, and before you know it, the cowl vents are being taken out. What used to pass for air conditioning will instead supply room for the windshield and create something of a dashboard.
You know, he was more like just hot rod, normal kind of hot rod thing, and I was pushing really the heavy, heavy tradition. Don't trust me here. So he started doing research, and he's like so on board with the like hardcore traditional car.
If it's a steel body and it's from Brookville, you know you're building a serious deuce. Where else but Tinseltown would someone be building a pair of twin sister roadsters? Like everything here, it all has to be anything but average. Building one at a time might be fine if your shop was any place else, but luckily for us, these two girls are in Hollywood.
This is where we're at.
And here at Hollywood Hot Rods, of course, it's a double feature. Ask 15 hot rodders about a phrase like traditional hot rods. Guess what? You'll get 15 different, very committed statements. These days, for some builders, traditional hot rods is becoming a contradiction of terms. With new parts being hooked up alongside old parts, the rules are all out the window. Some guys are purists when it comes to original vintage parts going on era-specific rides. Others will pick and choose when it comes to putting modern performance into classic cars. That's something they know at Hollywood Hot Rods, where Troy and his team get back to work on a pair of new, yet classic, 32 Roadsters.
Basically, this is the engine we have for the first of the two Roadsters, this one here, actually. We were looking for something to promote the traditional theme. We're really trying to keep this a traditional car. It's not a street rod, this is a hot rod. So a couple choices come to mind, you know, old nailhead, Hemi, things like that. This particular owner has Pontiacs and owned other Pontiacs, so we decided that that was a different enough engine with a really nice nostalgia feel to build for this car.
Specifically, it's a 400 cubic inch Pontiac, bored and stroked out to 467. Its aluminum Edelbrock heads were treated to resemble cast iron, again, serving up that notion of form mixing with function.
It's the same thing as what people are doing today with a lot of the high-end street rods. You know, taking a new Viper engine, putting it in a street rod, now is equivalent to, you know, in the 60s, taking out a 60s muscle car engine and putting it in your hot rod.
This one-of-a-kind motor was assembled by drag racer and engine builder Bob Lembeck, and it includes a one-off aluminum tri-powered manifold, topped by three Rochester carbs.
Good on this side.
Come this way, come my way a little bit.
Okay. That. Right there. There it is. Back in the car. And it fits. Ta-da! And there it is. Pontiac in a Ford.
Well, at least the dash is from a Ford, but it's off about 8 years, so Troy has to reshape it.
Basically, this is the original dash out of a 40 Ford. We decided to put this into the first 32 with the Pontiac. This is something that was done back in the 50s and 60s as far as hot rod building is concerned. It's a really good looking dash. It's got a chrome grille that goes here. It's nice and round and kind of art deco. It adds to the overall feel of the car. What we have to do is change the dash extensively because it doesn't actually fit in the 32.
One of the modifications he'll need to make is to pull an inch and a half off each end of the dash. And this whole new look will apply to the gauges as well. They've all been sent out for redone faces and numbers.
We asked them for this car to rescreen print the speedometer to go to 180 instead of 80, which would have stock. The oil pressure gauge will go to 150 instead of 60 or 30 or whatever it went to in 1940.
But just when it seems that it's all new and all high tech, it's an old school method that will be used to smooth out our old school dash.
What we're gonna do right now is we're gonna put a little bit of lead. We're gonna get the lead out and put some of it into this dash. This is actually a little small dent on the glove box door, and since it's a double-walled panel, we can't get behind it, and it's just more practical to go ahead and fill it, and since it's so small, that's what we're gonna go ahead and do. What I've done is ground away the metal a little bit to clean it and applied a flux, which allows the lead to adhere to the steel properly. So we're gonna heat it up and melt some lead.
It's a simple idea that more than likely dates back before the car itself. One material melts faster than the other. The steel dash would melt at over 2,500 degrees, where the lead melts at a quarter of that temperature.
It's really just gigantic soldering. So now we'll just let this cool down, and then we can go to grinding it and smoothing it. No more dent. Now it's feeling pretty good.
So we can go ahead and put the firewall in now.
And after the firewall, it's four bias ply tires. Up next, a modified radiator, followed by a Duval-styled windshield. The reason for getting rid of those cowl vents many moons ago.
there's a Duval windshield.
It's starting to look like a car, and a lot of the credit has to go to our mystery man, the guy with so many nicknames.
Well, his name's Troy, but we call him T2, the youngest one in curls. Let's see, noodles, because the guy always eats top ramen every day, top ramen. So noodles, T2, Nashville. What other ones do we have for him?
I first started in body work back in Nashville, where I'm from. And I did a little bit of general metal work there and then carried it on into mechanics and learned more welding in college and machine work and a little bit of metallurgy. And then moved out here to get into hot rods.
The funny thing is I get like resumes nearly every day. Like everyone wants to work in a hot rod shop, living the dream, you know? It's not as glamorous as you think, you know?
Catch that?
What we did catch are all those nicknames. We'll go with Noodles, as he works with Randy to put the fuel tank onto the Ford and bolt it into place.
Basically, I'm gonna start to plumbing the carburetors, and the idea we had for the carburetors was to do everything in polished stainless hard lines. Each stainless hose is going to come out and then down. This one's going to come out and down, and this one will come out and down, so they end up three like this. We're going to make the same kind of deal here. That way we'll have both of the hard lines ending up like this, and then we'll connect the two small pieces of rubber hose.
As the hard lines are about to go in, the hard questions are thrown at Troy, and it seems that he'd like a little help with the answer.
Is this the part where I ask the studio audience to call in and vote? Should it be tight, or should I have a gap and make some spacers? I think I want a gap.
And with that decision, the pair of rides is one step closer to hitting the street.
All right. We're getting there.
Let's return to that 1 year anniversary for Hollywood Hot Rods. Many of the friends here at the celebration share their love of most things retro and all things cool. And if a few of their faces look a bit familiar, it's because we've met them before. Old buddies like our pals, the Burbank Choppers.
Have you been on TV before?
Jump on right now.
For a lot of these people, you can't know them until you know their cars. And to help us out in that department, the lovely DeVita of Hollywood Hot Rods is going to tell us about some of their rides.
We've had a fabulous turnout, and I'm going to do my best to tell you about the cars. This is a car from SoCal. They graciously brought it down, and I think it's really famous. This is another really cute roadster. I'm partial to the convertibles myself. This, I think, is what they affectionately refer to as a rat rod. Some people like that term, some people don't.
Rat rod. Hot rod.
All right.
Hot rod.
All right, hot rod. Rats need loving too.
Okay, one guy wants to handle this by himself.
A Model T body, a roadster with a back cut off, and newly formed metal back here.
And this is a green car. It reminds me of Vegas for some reason.
It's got a Dago axle, suicide front end.
This guy liked green and sparkles a lot.
Hydraulic brakes.
And I like the teeth. I think it's called a grill. Just kind of gives it a kind of a grr look.
And it's got a 6-inch Z-bar in the back.
I guess it would be a chopped, what do they call these things?
50 mercury crank in it, 5/16 overbore.
It's like not a bullet, but it's some kind of sled, lead sled. This is a lead sled.
Escuderian cam, Navarro heads and manifold.
There must be a lot of lead, and it may look like a sled.
It's strictly, in my old age, a puddle jumper.
So, as this hit of a party winds down, Troy and his crew get back to work on the pair of 32 Roadsters. They're 3 months into the build, and their client, John Riddle, is a guy who would like to see these cars running sooner rather than later.
Today we're actually going to bend up the brake lines for the car, install all the brake lines, finish the plumbing. We'll also probably put the body back on, because we have the seats. We got seats for the car. Pre-fit the seats. We have a sample steering column, pre-fit the steering column with the 40 dash. We're trying to fit all these things together that really kind of don't belong. Well, they're gonna belong.
With its new, very trick Pontiac engine, Roadster 1 is the ride we'll call Big Sister. And this 32 is moving along nicely. Nice enough to make Little Sister a bit jealous. But just as it seems that life really isn't fair to Little Sister, up drives the Tooth Fairy, with a present that's gonna do more than merely allow the cars to play catch-up with one another. This Tooth Fairy is also known as Cammy Edelbrock, and if you know engines and car parts, you know exactly who she is.
I broke the brakes.
You broke the brakes?
But see, there's forward and reverse, so when you start going forward and you want to stop, you hit reverse.
Is your brother okay with this?
Probably not.
Why is he still letting you drive the forklift?
Because he's scared to death to do it himself.
I can drive it.
It's
he
all about
do
hot
it.
Rods, but yeah, no forklift.
I'll build. He can fork.
Oh, okay.
That's what I do
best.
He
does all the forking around
he's
here.
He's the fork guy. All right.
Oh, boy. We're going to get Noodles for a safety block for me. In case I start rolling, we'll shove it under the back.
So Noodles is the brake.
Noodles is the brake.
Noodles is the brake.
We hired Noodles. Instead of fixing the brakes, we just hired Noodles.
A high five for the brake.
Yeah, right.
Phew. Come on, baby.
Well, it is a big crate, and Cammy and her family are known for cool motors. So if anyone had to make a guess, it seems that the delivery here just might be one much-desired crate motor.
Oh.
Pretty, huh?
It's gorgeous.
This is a customized Hollywood hot rod engine.
It's exactly what we were looking for.
So now that the power is in the house, Little Sister gets hooked up with an automatic four-speed transmission and that Edelbrock V8. That installation is followed by a set of reconditioned carburetors, completing this tri-powered setup. And with those three deuces now topping the tower, it's time to see how they're gonna be tricked out.
At this point, it has not been determined what we're using for air cleaners or scoops, so we thought we'd try a couple of different versions on and see what we think. Like Vanna White, do it. So that's one way. I don't like it.
I don't like it either.
Another option is to use these little scoops like that. I face them back. I like them back. I think they're supposed to be back. I've seen other people run them forwards, almost like little scoops, but I believe they're actually originally were designed to run the back, or they work better the back way. I don't know. More people run them in reverse than forward. I don't know why. I'm sure there's a big history lesson to be learned there, but I don't know it, so. And that's pretty much what that would look like, and I really like that. Our last option are these guys.
See, I like those.
You like those?
I like those. But it's almost too much
fin.
Too much fins.
Okay, enough attention on the little sister of the pair. It's time for Big Sister to get her body back together. It'll take the whole crew to get the job done.
Excellent. Looks like a car again.
The momentum is moving, the pieces are fitting, and it's clear that they're eager to have these cars heading down the road. Maybe a little too eager.
Hop in, try it out. Take it for a try.
And this concludes our episode.
Yeah.
We will now drive off into the sunset.
Okay.
Cool.
Okay. Now you're freaking me out, beat it.
No, officer, I haven't been drinking. What do you mean my car's not finished?
And soon, we'll see how one client will be able to drive two cars at the same time. In Burbank, California, we know that young Troy Ladd runs Hollywood Hot Rods. But to really get to know a car guy, you gotta do two things. Meet his ride, and then take a ride.
I used to street race back in, gosh, that was like the 80s, and I got in trouble and kind of put a stop to my street racing career. And in my second offense, it was like a huge deal. They were supposed to take my license and the fines, and it was supposed to be just a crazy deal. I ended up going to the court on the wrong day, and they didn't have my paperwork, and I was in there with a bunch of like prostitutes and forgery guys and things. So when my case came up, the judge looked at it, and he's like, so you were racing your car on the street? I'm like, yeah. He's like, that's what you're in here for? I'm like, yeah. He's like, $100 fine, get out of my court.
He got out of that court, but it probably wasn't the last of Troy's racing days. That's a safe bet to make if you've ever been in his cool car, a certified hot rod.
Basically, it's just a little budget beater. I mean, you could go so far as to call it a rat rod, I suppose. Not real fond of that term particularly, but it's basically fairly era-specific. Era-correct, it's supposed to look like a race car from like the early 60s. And it's very budget. You know, I built it with not a whole lot of money. Been driving, I guess, 7 years or so. Literally built it like in the carport of my apartment. This car gets unruly.
His love of cars started early. You could say it was handed down in the family.
When I was 16 years old, my dad gave me a 66 Mustang, and that was my first car. And that was handed down from his dad. And that was, you know, how I really got into just driving. I didn't know anything about cars or anything about, you know, hot rods or what have you. And basically, it started out of necessity. I had that car. I grew up fairly poor. I mean, I didn't have much money, but I had this car. So when something went wrong, basically, it's now what do I do?
What he did had nothing to do with hot rods and everything to do with the big real world.
I did what you're supposed to do. You go to college, you get a degree, you get a job in the corporate world, you work up the deal, work for the man.
But in the end, it all worked out. Now he had both business knowledge and his desire to own his own shop. All he needed now was a name, and his girlfriend DeVita claims that one night, that simply made itself clear.
It came to him in a dream, and I just remember one day he woke up and he said, I thought of the best name, Hollywood Hot Rods. And I was like, oh yeah, that's a good name. I thought it kind of limited him to Hollywood, but it kind of grew on me, and I think it really was a fabulous name. But yeah, it came to him in a dream.
As most people kind of start small in their garage, work to a little bigger place, work up. Since I've been doing this so long for myself anyway, I already had a pretty good network of acquaintances and relationships in the industry, and with a business background, I decided to take a different side to it. So what if I create a legitimate corporate, like not large scale, but hit it a little bit bigger and harder to compete on a larger level?
I think there's kind of a, with young guys like me and Troy, 35, 36 year olds, we kind of see ourselves as carrying a torch. The way we saw the cars that were built in the late 40s, 50s, and early 60s, we have an appreciation for it, and we feel like we're kind of carrying a torch forward. There's a lot of cars out there and a lot of guys that are building cars that are what get termed rat rod. We're kind of taking that aesthetic, but we're putting a little bit of dough into it and trying to do it the right way.
Pete Santini and his son Nick have come to Hollywood Hot Rods to see the roadsters that will receive their expert paint jobs. Pete is a legend in the color game, and it's a lucky ride that gets a Santini finish.
So pretty much on the frame, I don't think you'll be filling or smoothing anything, just cleaning up.
Okay.
You know,
cool.
So when it's shiny, it looks like it's supposed to be.
Now, is this getting a gasket up here too then?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is fine the way it is? You want to go in there and grind
point.
It a little bit so it sits a little flatter?
We'll probably work that a little bit.
Okay.
Or
Yeah, that's a little rough right there.
So now that the ideas are out and about for the ride known as Big Sister, it's time to get the colors into motion for her little sister.
This one will get steel wheels, so we need to come up with a paint color for the wheels.
Well, what's the paint color of the body?
We're not sure.
It's not every builder who can get Pete Santini to put the finish on his client's hot rods. But then again, not every builder has known Pete Santini since childhood.
Well, this is unusual having Troy as my boss. You know? He used to come to my house in his little beater 65 Mustang. Hey man, can I borrow a screwdriver? You got any extra gas? You got any jumper cables?
That was a long time ago.
Yeah, so you get to boss me around now, man.
Excellent.
You get to call me up and go, how's the timing? How you doing? When's it gonna be done? My customer's screaming at me. You know, then you can call me up and go, hey, we got some issues. See, that's what people say. We don't have problems, we have issues. There's issues in the paint.
Oh, there won't be any issues.
There's the issues, okay.
Well, right now, the biggest issue of all is this to-do chart hanging at Hollywood Hot Rods.
Each one of those items, if it has to do with fabrication or steel, has to be done before it goes to paint. 11 days.
But before that can happen, all those details need to be addressed. Details both small and large. In fact, some of these details are so large, they're really not details at all.
Making headers, a lake style, race header. That's better. Going back.
So as the headers start to take shape on the Pontiac engine, Noodles is working across the shop, putting together some housings for the other car.
Floorboard took, I guess, about right around an hour to make. And the main bell housing tunnel probably took me about 30 minutes, 45 minutes. Not too bad, it turned out pretty easy.
I just need to move that stuff up.
Where do you want that pipe, you know? Should it angle down, should it angle flat, should it angle extremely down? What lines of the engine and car should it pick up? It's got a little bit of a downward slope, but it kind of, we kind of split the difference with the lines of the engine, and also we have a body line here. So when you stand back, it kind of, this kind of follows this body line, but then doesn't disrupt those lines. So, a lot of lines.
A lot of lines, and not much time. There are more than just a pair of 32 Roadsters being built here at Troy Ladd's Hollywood Hot Rods. In fact, there's a whole fleet of customs coming together, a pack that includes this rare Zephyr. And this way cool 51 Chevy, belonging to a guy who's as unique as the ride.
It is a 1951 Chevy Styleline Coupe Deluxe. Yeah, bought this thing bone stock about a couple years ago. Then I did some mild modifications on my own, you know, bolt-on parts, some leg pipes, you know, a little this and that. But after a while, I got hungry for something a little more severe. Then I started hanging around with the Hollywood Hot Rod boys, met up with Troy at his grand opening, and then I got whacked. Then I was like, you know what? I think I want to chop it. A lot of cats were like, dude, that's kind of severe. I don't know if you need all that. And I was like, oh, yeah, I do. And then it was on, and he broke out the Sawzall and put that thing on this like it was a hot piece of butter. And after much deliberation, much sketching, much, you know, back and forth, voila, the Zulu machine.
Thank you.
So now, the Zulu machine is back here at Hollywood Hot Rods, ready for a continuation of the transformation. The chop is so severe on Zulu's 51 Chevy, Troy and his team have decided to tackle the metalwork one piece at a time.
Now we have a new radiused door trim piece. And we have seams throughout this area here, and we weld them up, grind them away, and if it's done right, you're not supposed to be able to see that anything ever happened. So you can see how it's in bare metal before finishing in paint, and it's nearly indiscernible. So we continue to fit these to the door and make sure everything works, and then we'll have one more piece to the chopped car. This piece we fit like this, in there like that. It looks like we have a winner.
Zulu actually wanted, like I said, 7.5 inches out of the rear and 5 inches out of the front. We tried to go a little bit more conservative, and he wouldn't have it, so we did it how he wanted. Just that he wanted that one extra inch, increased the work involved by nearly double. So basically, from here to here, all this is new hand rolled steel. We didn't piece the old pieces back together. Actually, just threw it in the trash and just rolled out new panels. And I actually I designed the chop, cut the car, put the car back together, and then, like I said, he worked on some of the specific pieces. And then together we welded them in. And the back window, we couldn't find a back window that we liked. We were gonna lay, we took the original one, you can lay it down. It was too big and it didn't match all of the round curves that we ended up with the teardrop design. So my guy just decided that he'd just make one from scratch. And I was a little skeptical on that, but I left for lunch, came back, and he had it almost done, and it looks great. So he basically matched the lines of the rest of the car to give it an overall, just a whole new look. One of the things still left to do on this car is, we're making glass patterns for it, put the glass in. The hardest part about chopping a car is the glass, always. Period. This is the factory glass for this car that's been cut. It's been cut all the way around, I believe, yeah, the upper perimeter, all the way down to this corner. Like I said, about 5+ inches. So this used to be, somewhere like that.
Well, as far as completion on this car, we're about 70%. Of course, one of the big things is paint. I'm not sure if I'm going to keep it suede or if we're going to throw some, glass paint on this thing. But for now, I'm going to leave it like it is. I kind of dig it, just kind of raw. But as you can see, the interior is still just, bare metal, no headliner, no nothing. That'll be the next step, get this thing looking spiffy.
So, as Zulu figures out the future of the fantastic Zulu machine, that pair of 32 Roadsters continue their journey onto the finish line. And at the moment, it looks like the crew is rapidly approaching the home stretch.
I want the rear brake system bled and checked for leaks. Everything from here back needs to be finish tightened. Check the pinion angle on this guy. And then so we can set the body on, we won't have to deal with anything under. And then in the meantime, since this guy is so far along, you could set up the radiator and start making the stainless steel coolant lines. So, like I said, everything besides that crossmember, everything under the chassis should be done.
New from Wyotech, Garrett Wilson is putting in a few hours today at Hollywood Hot Rods. And like all of the young guys who get hold of Troy on a daily basis, Garrett's getting to live out his dream of being a car builder.
So we need to fit the aluminum ring.
Meanwhile, Troy and Noodles tackle that radiator over on Little Sister.
So you want to move it back a little?
Actually, you can put it wherever you want then. You can go ahead and centerline it.
Yeah.
So I'll put a half inch spacer on this. Once it's cut down, everything should clear.
Okay.
It's modification time here on this hot rod. But here's the deal when it comes to these custom hand-built rides. With these cars, every single bit of it all is modification time.
Troy.
Hey.
Gauges. Instrument cluster.
Excellent.
Ta-da.
Beautiful.
See, we went from, instead of 100 miles an hour, you wanted a higher readout, so mm-hmm. 180 fit in the scale real perfect.
Nice.
Stuck to the original font.
Mm-hmm.
Went to the color that he picked out to kind of match the interior.
It keeps coming in as Pete Santini arrives with surprises of his own for the sisters. First out is the blue body of the little sister Roadster, a car that is already impressing its owner. Watching as the perfectly painted body enters the shop and goes onto the chassis, John has been debating a recent thought he's been kicking around: keeping the black Roadster and selling the blue one once it's completed.
It needs to be lower.
Yeah. It's killer.
It came out good. Perfect color.
I mean, we went through some testers, me and Troy ourselves, and couldn't
Pete
get it.
Yeah, Pete wasn't around for that part.
No.
We bought some paint, we sprayed a door, we looked at some things, and then finally the end result of that testing was Pete Pickett.
Yep.
That looks good. It's perfect. It's real retro.
You guys are making it hard for me to keep both of these things? I would love to keep both of them. I mean, everybody that sees it now is going, man, that blue car is just sweet. It's hard to say what's going to happen with it. If I had parking spaces, I'd probably keep the thing, but I think that I'm running out of parking spaces and my wife's getting a little bit short with that.
His wife will probably be fine with this slick black Roadster, a classic car that is going to end up being a member of John's family. A second work of art that will undoubtedly be the center of a perfect hot rod. At this stage, with all of the work that's been done on both cars, the hard part now is in the waiting. But waiting is what it's gonna have to be, as more of the final details are still on Troy's to-do list. Details like the interior touches, including elements such as the gauges and the steering column. Parts that have to be both installed and adjusted.
See, if it doesn't have enough swing, we gotta change the ratios on them, on the arms. I guess we'd have to come in here.
I don't know. It'll probably only take about 6 hours to figure out.
Yeah.
But I'm sure we'll figure it out.
They have to figure it all out. Every wire, switch, lever, and cable. None of this came with a kit. It's a pack of freelance parts and pieces that are somehow coming together to create a car. No, make that two cars. So they now have their bodies back, but at the moment, these girls don't have their seats, a reality that is about to change.
Hey, upholstery guys are here.
You like that?
All right. This is for the blue car?
Yeah. Yep. We didn't want to throw down something that looked like a new car interior, and I wanted to bring in something that was, that had a vintage feel, had a kind of a beat up feel to it. A friend of mine owns a furniture company, and I went over to his shop and was talking to him, and he's got some really trick leathers, some distressed Italian leathers that they use for furniture.
Well, what we did is we sat the seat in there, and we had John sit in the car so we can get the proper height and everything and where we wanted the seat located. And then we added foam. There's probably got about 3 inches of foam to the top, and it's just rolled in. And it sits right across the top right there on the edge. And we just sand the foam down until we get the desired shape, and it works pretty good.
The blue one was kind of the more simple, you know, cookie cutter of the two cars. You know, small block Chevy and a 32, that's not groundbreaking or anything, but just the impact that it has and the overall style that it's developed into, it really captures the spirit, the idea that we're trying to do, the traditional spirit. I think the blue car captures it better than the black car.
this stage, it's hard to imagine a time when the cars seemed interchangeable, now that they've each taken on an identity of their own.
As the two cars sat by side and they, you know, grew towards completion, like, wow, they kind of went two different directions. We thought they were going to be twins, but they're, you know, like DeVita says, they're not identical twins, they're fraternal twins.
And as talk over the interior goes on, a key date is looming for this Roadster. A test will soon take place on a dry lake bed. It's a powerhouse of an exam that will prove whether this car is a true hot rod or just another pretty thing standing around and posing here in Hollywood. Troy, John, and the gang from Hollywood Hot Rods want to see the now completed pair of 32s in action. So it's off to the El Mirage Dry Lake Bed. That's the Southern California proving ground for all things hot rod. Both cars are ready to show their stuff, and the first ride out of the chute is the black Roadster, known to us all as Big Sister.
Where else? Where else would you debut something like this? This is perfect. You know, a place like this or even a drag strip, but you know, the setting here is just incredible. I mean, just with like the desert floor, the cars, the chrome, the sunlight, you know, it's incredible.
Well, I think, you know, the whole California West Coast thing really was born out in a situation like this, out at the dry lake beds, and for the most part, drag racing in general out here. There's just such a rich history with these cars and this place. There's a whole aesthetic with these cars, this setting, with the traditional Roadsters, and we've, in my opinion, we've nailed it.
I mean, the whole concept, the whole style of these cars has grown from, you know, the early styles of motorsports, you know, like the drag racing and then the land speed, you know, salt flats, dry lakes, things like that. I mean, half the things, the speed equipment, half the stylish, you know, the style parts we have on the car have evolved from these different motorsports.
This is their element. This is their element. They belong out here. Yeah, I just think cars like this, the traditional Roadsters, you know, they don't belong in shows. I don't think. This setting is just absolutely perfect. I mean, you take a look at these things sitting out here on the desert floor, and they just want to go. They just want to go.
So now, guess who wants to come out and play? And why not? Big Sister can't have all the fun.
Came out totally different. One of them has just a really traditional kind of early car nostalgia feel. The other one has turned into more of kind of an early race car, almost sinister feel. That engine is really burly. That's a whole lot of engine in a little car like that. It's incredible. That is a hot rod. That's just an evil, nasty hot rod, you know? I mean, yeah, don't challenge that car if you can see it on the street. It's a mean car.
Okay, but while Little Sister might seem like, well, like the Little Sister, don't count her out with her tricked out Edelbrock Performer. And appropriately enough, the time warp that first started this journey continues, presenting a site that has a lot of history in the world of classic cars. Roadsters cruising on this very special piece of earth. If that's not true hot rodding, then nothing is.
Well, even aside from the cars, just being here, you can just feel, you know, the power of just many, many years of tradition and competition and racing. I mean, there are very few places that have as much, power as this place. And it's all tied in with hot rodding. Then we bring those here, and just to see them sit here, you know, with their silhouettes against the sun, it's breathtaking. I mean, with the risk of sounding sappy, you know, I mean, it's incredible. It really kind of brings a tear to your eye almost. It's pretty powerful.